Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Best Australian Trucking Stories, written and read by Jim Haynes. Introduction. My only claim to fame in the trucking world is that I've held a heavy vehicle driver's license since I was 21 years old. As a young single school teacher in the bush, I boarded with a family who owned a drilling business. And one day the local police sergeant asked me when I was going to get a truck license. "Why do I need one of those?" I asked. "Well," he said, "you've been driving those trucks of Kolstad's around for a while now. I thought you might want one." "Me? Driving trucks?" I replied nervously. No, not me, Sergeant. I don't really need one, do I? I only move the trucks around the yard, mostly." "Look, Jim," he said seriously, "stop lying to me. I know why you haven't come in for a truck license driving test." "Oh," I said, "why's that?" "Because," he sighed, "if you turned up to get your license in one of those trucks you've been driving around the bush, I'd probably have to put it off the road for many and varied defects. So just drop into the station tomorrow and I'll give you a bloody truck license. Okay?" I did. And he did. And I still have it. When I was asked to compile, edit, and help write this collection of stories, certain of my younger musical friends who knew nothing of my trucking claim to fame found it rather amusing. They seemed to think that truckies were rough, tough, macho men, strong and independent, practical, physical types of blokes, and that I wasn't. Little did they know that I had spent some time as a truck driver, albeit a very brief period now, decades in the distant past. I also had connections. Although I had no direct contact at all with truckies or trucking, my first thought was that I knew people involved in the trucking community through my connections with country music. I'd toured as part of the Slim Dusty Show and served on the board of the Country Music Association for many years with Slim and Joy McKean. Slim recorded many trucking songs and was universally loved by truckies, and Joy wrote the best trucking song of all time, Lights on the Hill. I'd done shows with Travis Sinclair, who comes from a trucking family, owns and drives a big rig, and has had many hits with truck songs. I was also friends with singers like Jane Denham and Amber Lawrence, who both had sponsorships with trucking companies. I knew I'd find some good trucking stories if I asked around. I was right. When I called Slim's daughter, Anne Kirkpatrick, to ask about material for a story, she said, "Jim, why don't you just call John?" An old friend of Slim's and mine, photographer and journalist John Elliott, was the obvious person to turn to for good stories about Slim and the truckies. John travelled many thousands of kilometres with Slim and was the photographer for many of Slim's albums and books. Thanks to John, I didn't have to strain my memory banks about Slim's connection with trucks. Luckily for me, two good mates, Grant Lurs and Frank Daniel, also came to the rescue. I've known Grant for 30 years, since we met performing at the Long Yard in Tamworth. I've recorded in his studio in Wagga, and we've been partners in crime running opposing shows at the Tamworth Festival for years, as well as travelling to other festivals together. Grant was also involved in Rig Radio, a radio show for the trucking community, and he put me in touch with Rod Hanafy, who was a terrific help in getting this collection together, providing several great contributions of his own, making many useful suggestions, and sending me the poem by Cheryl Vandervelden. Rod Hanafy was involved in Rig Radio and also runs the Truck Right Industry Vehicle, a truck in which he takes motoring journalists, politicians and representatives from road authorities for long hauls so they can see and understand the issues facing the road transport industry. The website, www.truckright.com.au, gives tips on sharing the road with trucks and welcomes comments and feedback. Grant has also been involved with the Tarkata Memorial, and I knew people like Ron Pullen and Erwin Richter, who were part of the driving force behind the memorial. Both Ron and Irwin have a long history of involvement with the road transport industry. Their stories appear here, as does Grant's story about Rig Radio, and their memories and assistance with the collection have been invaluable. It's odd how things are connected sometimes. Grant arrived at my place one day with some recorded memories of Ron's and said, "Ron sent this brochure about the Tarkata Memorial in case it might be useful." I opened it as we chatted, and there was a photo of Slim Dusty doing a fundraising concert for the memorial. Standing right next to Slim on stage was, yours truly, Jim Haynes. Neither Grant nor Ron had realised I was featured in the brochure, and I had no idea either. Frank Daniel always comes good when I need help with a book, whether it's poetry or a yarn or a contact. Frank owned a trucking business for many years and operated a fleet of 16 vehicles out of his hometown of Canoundra. But I've known him for almost 20 years as a writer and performer of bush verse. We've done a few thousand kilometres and a lot of shows together in that time. I knew Frank was the man who dumped the load of wheat at Parliament House in 1986, and I figured that would be a good story for the collection, if I could pester him into writing it. I figured he'd have a few more good yarns about his trucking days if I annoyed him enough. He didn't let me down. I soon came to realise that the trucking community is full of very gracious and helpful people who also happen to be just about the most Aussie characters you can find anywhere. There's a general desire among them for the transport industry to be seen in a positive and realistic light. Everyone I talked to was enthusiastic about conveying a true picture of the role played by the road transport industry in Australia's development and history. They all felt that truckies had been given a raw deal by the media and suffered from negative perceptions and a stereotyped image. The more I had to do with them, the more I realised they were right. Everyone I approached for help with this collection was amazingly generous and helpful and enthusiastic about the project. The day I called Liz Martin in Alice Springs and introduced myself was a truly lucky one for me. Liz Martin, OAM, has been so helpful in providing stories and contacts and suggestions that it's no wonder she is so admired for her efforts in getting the National Road Transport Hall of Fame to become a reality in Alice Springs. She's an inspirational woman. The website for the Hall of Fame is www.roadtransporthall.com, and it's worth the trip to Alice Springs just to visit the hall. Thanks to Liz, I now know a bloody lot more about road transport history than I did 12 months ago. Meeting the Nullarbor kid, Ray Galleland, was a genuine thrill for me. I'd read his stories because Jane Denham had told me I had to, and we finally met up when I was working in a show at Twin Towns RSL on the Gold Coast. Ray is a larger-than-life character. There's no bullshit in Ray's yarns. What you see is what you get, and what you read really happened. They're fantastic stories. Ray's book, My Way on the Highway, is still available direct from Ray, nullarborkid@hotmail.com, for those of you who want more of his stories. Kingsley Foreman and Sharon Horn were very gracious in providing their stories, and I thank them both sincerely. Kingsley's stories made me laugh out loud, and Sharon's will break the hardest heart. I admire her bravery in telling her story so that others can understand the tragedy that too often comes with the trucking life. Steve Theobald emailed me after I'd talked about truck stories on 2UE one Sunday. He had a story from his childhood that he allowed me to use after his dad had added a few details and memories. It's a wonderful, heartwarming yarn too. Apologies to all those who contacted me with stories and ideas that I didn't get around to including. So many stories came out of the woodwork as the collection was being put together. Jeff Spence, Tony Dyer and Alan Robb were especially helpful, but those stories, like so many others, will have to wait for Volume 2. Jim Haynes, October 2011. The Aussie Truckie. Traditional, Jim Haynes. When the Lord was creating all things, all the elements, plants, creatures and people, he'd made it to the sixth day without tiring, although he'd been on overtime for a couple of days. Each creature required special care and attention, and when it came to humanity, all professions and nationalities had to be unique. It was a boutique manufacturing, not production line stuff. Nurses and teachers required extra doses of patience and tolerance. Politicians needed extra thick skins and two faces. Television personalities needed permanent smiles and the ability to fake sincerity. And authors and editors required extra doses of endurance and intelligence. God had managed to create most types and professions when an angel working on quality control noticed that the creation process had slowed significantly. The angel, whose name from memory was Steve, was just starting out in his new job as apprenticed archangel. I believe the Catholics later made him patron saint of spanners and wingnuts, and you can pray to him instead of swearing when you skin your knuckles under a vehicle. "You're slowing down, boss," said St. Steve. "You seem to be taking a lot of time on this one. What's the problem?" And the Lord answered, "Thou shouldst see the specks on this order. It's near impossible, even for me." "Maybe you're just getting tired," said St. Steve gently. "Have another go after Smoko. What is it you're trying to create anyway?" "It's a thing called the Aussie truck driver, apparently," said the Lord, checking the front of the manual. "Sounds relatively straightforward," remarked Steve. "What's the problem?" "Well," answered the Lord, "this one has to be able to drive 10 to 12 or more hours per day through any type of weather on any type of road. They also have to know the highway traffic laws of 6 states and 2 territories, plus the federal laws, and be ready and able to unload 40 tons of freight after driving all night and have the ability to sleep when they can in places that the police refuse to patrol." "Gee, boss," said St. Steve, checking out the front of the manual as he stood beside his leader. "That means extra doses of concentration and endurance, amazing memory and superhuman strength, plus extra vigilance and the ability to work on minimal rest." "Just as thou sayest," replied the boss. "And this model also has to be able to live in a truck 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for months on end, offer first aid and roadside assistance to his fellow travellers, meet tight schedules, and still maintain an even and controlled composure through it all. These people also have to keep their heads in a crisis and act to very detailed specifications with a high level of motor skill accuracy in an accident." "I also see here," said St. Steve as he examined the specifications, "they have to be in top physical condition at all times and be able to operate on black coffee and half-eaten meals and have 6 pairs of hands." "Yea, verily," said the Lord, tapping the page St. Steve was reading. "But it's not the hands that are causing me problems. It's the 3 pairs of eyes a driver needs to have." "So I see," gasped St. Steve. "And that's on the standard model." "Yea, just as thou sayest," the Lord replied. "One pair that sees a herd of cattle in the scrub 3 miles away, another pair here on the side of the head for the blind spots that motorists love to hide in, and another pair in front that can look reassuringly into a spouse's face and say, 'It'll be all right. I'm fine. I'll get some rest when I get home.'" "Speaking of rest," said St. Steve, closing the manual, "you're looking tired. Why not have a spell and tackle this one later? Have a nice cup of tea and some smoko." "I can't," said the Lord. "Much as I wouldst liketh to, I've already managed to get this model to the point where it can drive 1,000 kilometres a day without incident, raise a family of 5 without ever seeing them, and survive on $1 a kilometre." St. Steve rubbed his chin and looked reflective. "What model brain are you installing?" "The best," said the Lord. "When operating properly, this model brain can tell you the elements of every chemical load invented, recite Australian road rules and regulations for each state while asleep, offer timely advice to strangers, search for missing children, and help make good parenting decisions that help raise a family of decent citizens without ever going home, and still keep its sense of humour. This Aussie truck driver also has to have phenomenal personal control. He has to deal with delivery and pickup areas designed by our main rival in hell. coax a loader to actually work for his money, comfort an accident victim's family, pay all taxes and fines, and put up with endless misguided criticism. With that, St. Steve leaned over his boss's shoulder to take a look at the unfinished model lying on the construction table. "It looks almost finished," he said with surprise. "How have you managed to put all that's required in?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.